Well, good afternoon and aloha. I wanted to have a conversation today about where we're at as a city, how we're looking at things, and just really communicate with the public, if you will, what our thinking is. You know, we've been at this now for quite some time. And so, coincidentally, it was nearly a year ago today, on September 23rd, prior to coming into office, that my predecessor, Mayor Caldwell, introduced the tier system. So nearly 1 year later, sort of, where are we? Well, before I get to that point, I just want to kind of do a quick walk through the tier system. In the beginning, our tiers were really focused on case counts, positivity rates. You know, and obviously they would have been looking at hospitals as well, hospitalizations, but those numbers remained fairly low. We were really fortunate. And our case counts, quite honestly, remained fairly low. And we came into office in January at tier two. We were able to work our way through to tier three, tier four. We had modifications in both of those tiers. And actually, as we got up to July 1st, we were looking and thinking that perhaps we were out the end of the tunnel. In fact, our thinking had shifted, along with the state and the Department of Health, to really looking at vaccination levels. And at that point, going into the month of July, we were just a shade under 60% of people being vaccinated throughout the state. And we were very encouraged by that number. And it looked as if we were able to get on top of the disease, and this is before the Delta variant raised its head. And so on July 8th, the city came back, or the state came back to us, and had come up with a tier five concept. And we talked about 65%. They would drop some restrictions. And seemingly only yesterday, they talked about at 70%, we'll drop all restrictions. So that's where we were when Delta began to really take off in around the third week of July. So everything shifted on that level. But before I get into those details, one of the things that I want to start off this meeting with today is I really want to acknowledge the public. We've had great response, great compliance, and not just from the public itself and getting it vaccinated, but from all the healthcare workers and various other entities that have stood up and provided access to not only get people vaccinated, but we've expanded our testing capability, you know, and I think it's evidenced in the numbers. So right now, as of today, 66.5% of our people in the entire state, our population, is fully vaccinated. Or said another way, two out of three people are fully vaccinated. And 75% in the whole state have now initiated a vaccine. So that's in the whole state. And of the people who are eligible, this excludes our keiki, which I'll talk about in a second, for those people who are eligible, 88.8% as of today have initiated a vaccine. So 75% throughout the state, including the entire population, and of those eligible, excluding 203,000 keiki, you have 88.8%. Or said another way, two out of three people are fully vaccinated, three out of four in the state are vaccinated, and nearly 9 out of 10 people have initiated a vaccine among the eligible people. The people who are still not vaccinated, as we have 203,000 keiki, and out of that 203,000, 119,000 are ages 5 to 11, and they're probably the next major subgroup should the vaccine become available prior to Halloween, which is the expectation right now, and the word we've received out of the FDA. So we'll see where that brings us, but right now the community has responded greatly. And, you know, we're really excited and feel good about that. However, we're still averaging almost 484 cases a day. In fact, as of today, that was the average. And over this past weekend alone, we had 35 fatalities. 35 people, Friday, Saturday, Sunday. Fortunately, today we had 0 deaths reported. And if we added in last Thursday, we had 8 then. We had 43 people pass away in just the last 5 days from this terrible disease. So with 484 cases a day average, fatalities being up the way they are, despite the vaccination levels being what they are, is still of great concern to us. So our hospitalizations, however, the good news are trending down, and we're really pleased by that. So I will tell you that I want to call back to an article that was in the Star Advertiser that was written on August 23rd, less than a month ago. And this article said, Hawaii's daily COVID cases are forecast to peak at 3,700 in October. Daily COVID cases. And the researcher here, a professor at the university, it's a good article, there's nothing wrong, said this is what the math says at that point, the way cases were escalating. but the only thing it says it couldn't predict was human behavior. And in fact, on August 5th, you know, our highest single day at that point was 655, and then just a mere 10 days later, we were at 845 cases. And then, going forward on that basis, on August 22nd, we hit another high mark of 893. So that's what we were up against. We were facing, a month ago, when we were looking at minimizing large gatherings, an unprecedented set of cases. You know, we were looking at not only the numbers of cases, but with that came the pressures on our hospitals. And suddenly our hospitals were at capacity. And as we were headed towards the Labor Day weekend, we had really great concern, because we know everybody's been tired from this. But yet the cases were mounting, and they were mounting without any precedence whatsoever. And it was really hard to difficult to predict. And the only thing we knew we could possibly do had something to do with human behavior. But I want to add one other line from this, because this was also daunting. It says, another forecast model for active hospitalizations on Honolulu shows a curve rising beyond 500 in September, surpassing 1,000 in October, and peaking at about 2,290 in late October. I mean, these are numbers that we just couldn't handle. I mean, right now, today, and I'm really pleased with that, mentioning our hospitalizations, on September 3rd, we were at 448 people in the hospital. That was our high peak. And today, we're at 308. 17 days later, we're down 148 hospitals. So that is really good. And it's the opposite of what that mathematical modeling was predicting. And so we're coming down, we're relieved by that. However, our ICU beds are still leveling off. We have right now between 70 and 80 people in ICU with COVID, and about 60 to 70 of those cases are still on ventilators. So, you know, we're not out of the woodwork yet. Yeah, we're not out of the fire yet, okay? So under those circumstances, and taking all of that into account, and recognizing that we've got great momentum in vaccines, we want to encourage everybody to continue getting vaccinated. We're averaging about 5,000 vaccines a day right now, which is very positive and very powerful on a going forward basis. But with our hospitalizations still remaining relatively high, at 484 of a seven-day case, although positivity rates are dropping, and a really good number of people, unfortunately, in ICU. After a lot of discussion with the State Department of Health, we're going to extend our suspension of large gatherings for another 28 days until October 19th. So that's the announcement today that we are going to make. But I want to tell you right now that if we continue on a positive trend, the sooner the better. You know, we will look at all of this. And so really, that's the adjustment we've made and what I wanted to share with everybody today. We went through some serious hard metrics that really shifted behaviors, businesses opening, and everything else. We're moving to a very different model. The tier model really hasn't been applicable since what I said earlier, early summer, going back to June, when we'd really kind of gone through the four-tier system and moved into a different realm of counting. We're now into a situation where whether we tighten or we loosen restrictions, it will be based on a broad set of circumstances, probably first and foremost, public health. We want the case counts to come down. We want to ensure that people are feeling and being safe. We're really pleased and very proud early on at the results and response we're getting on Safe Access Oahu. It seems to be going very well, just 1 week into it. But we know that the curtailing of large gatherings has a lot to do with communal spread, which is why we made the decision, and it's reflective in the numbers coming down. And so we're confident in this strategy, and we don't want to disrupt that strategy because we still have numbers we want to see come down. So at the end of the day right now, you know, we are going to base our decision-making going forward on whether or not we lift that suspension or what time we do it. Right now we're doing it for 28 days. It'll all be predicated on a broad set of conditions, starting out with public health, but the key metric will be our hospitals. We've said all along, there's a finite amount of resource in our hospital beds and our intensive care units. They're providing for other patients that are non-COVID related, and right now our hospitals are still very full. They are functioning, but they're still very full. We want to be sensitive to that, but we're headed in the right direction. So with that, I'll answer any questions that anybody has. And by the way, before I forget, I did make a note. You know, we implemented our suspension of large gatherings on August 25th for 28 days. On September 2nd, we had 1,068, and on September 3rd, we had 1,068 cases. Those are the 2 days we broke 1,000 cases. And keeping in mind what I said earlier about that modeling, I was of real concern. And during those 2 days, 11 people died. But as I just said, we lost 35 people just over this weekend. So our fatalities are still up. We don't want anybody else dying. We want to stop that as fast as we possibly can. And so we're going to do everything we can to prevent that from happening.
Tailing on that, Stuart Yurton with Civil Beat wants to know if you can clarify large gatherings again. Yep. What does that apply to?
Yeah, we're looking at 10 indoors and 25 outdoors. Look, and as far as that goes, I talked to Laura Thielen today. We've kept our parks open. We're trying to keep outdoor activities. Our gyms are closed. We're trying to keep the outdoor activities going. And so what they're doing is they're sort of staggering times and usage and whatever, and asking people who come as spectators to spread themselves out. We're trying to live as normal as we possibly can, short of, you know, having really large clumps of people put together.
From Ashley Mizua, she wants to know if you can give some specific examples of conditions that would allow restrictions to be lifted. Are there any concrete numbers you're looking at? Yeah.
No, we don't have any hard triggers. That's why I said it's going to be a broad sense of our, obviously, our case counts coming down, pressures on our hospitals. I would say that is a key metric. We continue to watch those drop. If I think, in fact, we just lowered it by 140 in 17 days. If some 17 days from now we've lowered it by another 140, we're headed in the right direction. Our case counts come down, positivity, all of that. And we're going to look at that continued increase in vaccines, even though it takes a while for the vaccines to take effect. We like the fact we have a critical mass right now where nearly 9 out of 10 people have initiated a vaccine. That's tremendous compliance and support for the community and for each other, because this is really a community decision in protecting ourselves and protecting each other.
If things trend in the right direction, do you have an order of what restrictions would be lifted first? Also from Ashley.
Well, I think, you know, just having watched the UH football game this past weekend with nobody in the stands obviously comes to mind. I know they have a Knicks homecoming game on October 2nd. But I think we'll look at anything and everything that gets us back to where we were before. We instituted Oahu Safe Pass, Safe Access Oahu. I'm sorry, I got so many. This is Oahu Safe. Safe Access Oahu, because we wanted to target the area where we felt that we knew we had the highest number of clusters outside of correctional facilities and restaurants, bars, and gyms, and that's got off pretty well at making people feel safe. But we didn't include a lot of other things. So, you know, we'd like to get to a place where we feel like we're back and we're doing really well. The efficacy of the drug is proven. And so we'll evaluate all of that when the time comes.
Part of that evaluation, maybe are you looking at a number for hospitalizations, or what point would you feel comfortable dropping this particular order? This is Manolo Morales.
You know, we've debated that. Is there a number? I would say right now we have to get well below 200, but there's not a hard number, but well below 200. And, you know, we have been in daily consultation with the hospitals. We talked to not only the CEOs, we have medical advisory teams and whatever, and we're looking at it really carefully. Right now we've had the benefit of nearly 600 FEMA workers on the ground helping our healthcare professionals. You know, and so it's not just about beds. I've said this before. People talk about inanimate things. They talk about hospital beds. They talk about ICU units. A couple of weeks ago, we had an oxygen crisis, which I think hopefully we've handled. But really what's behind all of that is the men and women who work laboriously and tirelessly in these hospitals taking care of these people. And so if it were not for the FEMA workers, I'm not so sure people might not have broken under this strain, because again, we have a limited amount of people to put against this disease.
Daryl Huff from Hawaii News Now asks if you can summarize what gatherings will not be able to take place under this extension that includes football spectators.
Well, I think the only thing that comes to mind is anything that would be large, like putting people in stands for football games, anything that would really bring any large groups together. So that's all we're asking for right now, is to refrain from that.
Jennifer Kelleher from the Associated Press Can you please provide clarity on Oahu rules for spiritual services?
Well, we left the churches alone. And that was a subject of a lot of debate and a lot of conversation because we know how people gather in churches and sing, and they're close to each other. And we're going to continue to stay away from the churches on that. That was one of the concessions we made last time, you know, against quite honestly, the opinion of a lot of people. But we, in the spirit of living our lives and having respect for people's desire to worship, and especially times like now when there's been so much strife, prayer is, for many people, an opportunity to go to church. It's a very powerful thing. So we're asking everybody to go to those houses of worship, no matter what denomination it might be, and to practice as safely as possible in the protocols.
Jennifer's also asking about funeral services. Do the 10 indoor and 25 outdoor still apply?
It does right now. We haven't changed that. I would tell you that going back to a prior question, one of the first things I would look for if we got some reprieve would be to help with funerals and weddings. We're very sensitive to both of those functions, are very much a key part of life.
Another one from Ashley Mizul. Will there be a scenario where the Safe Access Oahu program will no longer be needed? If so, how far out is that?
I hope so. You know, we purposely put that in for only 60 days. And again, we don't have a crystal ball, but if you go back and look at the numbers I said just 30 days ago, we were just looking right down the barrel of a gun, if you will, on the predictions. And there was a lot to be said for those math models because we were seeing it manifest itself in the actual case counts rising. As I just got done citing, we were in the 800s, and then we broke 1,000, and there seemingly was no end in sight. So we went to the Labor Day weekend begging everybody to be very careful, very fearful. Those two dates I just gave you at over 1,000 cases were just before the Labor Day weekend. So I feel very grateful on what's happened in the last 2 weeks. So, you know, while I would like to lift the whole thing, we've got a ways to go, but we're going to get there because I'm convinced with the amount of vaccinations and the way our community has responded to what we've asked of them, that we're going to get there.
Another one from Daryl Huff. How does it make sense to football teams that compete against each other with that large number of people, but not tennis tournaments or other sorts of sporting events? Is this an even playing field?
Well, I don't think it's an even playing field. You know, we have suspended all tournaments. To the best of my knowledge, you can go out and play tennis. I live right near three tennis courts. I see people playing there all the time. We just haven't had tournaments that would gather crowds. We've not stopped anybody from playing tennis. We've not stopped anybody from golfing. And we've not stopped anybody from even surfing. And in fact, you know, we're actually having cakey surf meets, and we're spreading it out, and we're trying to go on and be normal. So I'm not really quite sure of what he means by that, but we don't have any golf tournaments per se, but people are playing golf all weekend, all the time, every day.
Another one from the AP, just trying to clarify. So spiritual services are allowed, but funerals in churches, are those exempt?
No, to my knowledge right now, we're keeping the funerals down to 25 indoors. And again, this is one of those technical areas where we went back and forth with the Department of Health. So let me just be really clear. I want to take responsibility, but we work in concert with the Department of Health, and they were adamant on the subject of funerals and weddings to keep them at those numbers indoors. And again, this was a controversial decision with respect to the congregation, if you will, worshiping in a church versus having a funeral service inside of a church.
Esme Infante with Kumu wants to know about large events at the Blaisdell, like Joe Coy and large expos and conventions.
Right now, I don't believe we're allowing those structured events to happen. We'd like to get those to happen sooner rather than later. And that may also be one of the things that we'll lift when we get to that place where we can do that.
Another one from Stuart Yurton. There's been discussion that the cases are plateauing in Hawaii. Do you think that could happen?
I hope that happens. You know, we're seeing some signs of it. The case counts have come down yet again today. We're at, I think, 303. We've coming down steadily. We're just really hoping for the best.
Another one from Daryl. For your employees that have decided to ask for religious exemptions, have you denied any of them?
We have not denied. Everything has been reviewed. To my knowledge, no one has been denied a religious exemption.
Another one from Manolo. Have any city workers been fired besides the single lifeguard for not complying with the vaccine mandate?
No, I think some people are home on unpaid leave, and there's some discussions going on. Everybody has the opportunity to change their mind, and that's where we are right now. The other case, which I'm not going to talk about, is personnel. There are other matters involved with that.
Looks like that's it.
Look, I want to thank everybody. Everything and anything we're doing right now is about public safety and trying to develop good, sound public health policy at a time and in a situation that nobody has been in before, but we're doing it for the greater good and for the best of our people. I thank everybody again for a phenomenal response to our request to get people vaccinated, to lay low, to be observant, and do everything they possibly can to help us get through this period. We are in the right track. I think we've reversed a very bad trend. I'm just grateful to everybody. Mahalo.